Welcome to the Vine Resources Podcast Show with your host, David Lawrence.
Welcome to another edition of the Vine Resources Podcast Show, where today I've got a fantastic guest. His name is Max Versace. Max is the CEO of a really interesting company here. I'm really excited to share this with our listeners. He's the co-founder and CEO of Narella. Narella are based in Boston in the US. Max, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Max, you've got quite an interesting story of how a company's come from a research company into a commercial offering. But can you share with our listeners a little bit more background about who you are and who the company is, please?
Yeah, absolutely. So I was born and raised in Italy, and I started my undergrad career there in psychology, which quickly spilled into neuroscience and then from there in artificial intelligence. At that time, AI was not really a mainstream field as it is today. So I kind of taught myself the basics, and then I came for my PhD in the US. And that's where I met my two co-founders while doing our PhD at Boston University in AI. One was an American, Heather, and the other one a Russian, Anatoly. And so all together we came up with this idea of back then in 2005-ish using GPUs or graphic processing units, which are today the main processor used in AI. We had an idea of using it for a neural network or deep learning algorithm, which is the core of this AI revolution. And so we created the patent, and we were still in school, sucking our academic thumbs, if you will. And at that point, we created a company to very inexpensively in the US to contain it. But then it grew from there to become, our real job.
Fantastic. And tell us a little. I mean, obviously, those early days must have been very interesting. What did it look like? That first couple of years in the business, and or even I should say in academia, what was the biggest challenges you had in just bringing it all together at that point? And what was the most fun part of it?
Yeah, so the challenges have remained in terms of challenges, but they have changed completely in nature. So back then, the early pioneering time, people were thought that we were crazy or they just didn't take us seriously. The AI had some false starts already before, or some false promises, and they were just looking at us and say, well, I like you guys. You seem cute. We will fund some stuff, but take away all this stuff about AI, deep learning, because that doesn't sound good. It reminds us of failures. And back then, the challenge was to convince some people. And the people who were really early convincers or convincee, if you want, were the DARPA, right? So DARPA, which funds crazy stuff, obviously liked crazy people like us, and so gave us money. And we started to prove that this thing can work. And so DARPA, the US agency that funds little project like the internet or GPS that everybody's using today, got us a bootstrap. And then other agencies like NASA in particular picked us up and funded us along the way. So at the beginning, the easiest people to convince were governmental agencies, which promotes research-based high-risk endeavors. And then when the rest of the masses started to understand AI, that was real and we were not crazy, then it started to become easier to get money from venture firms and then eventually get customers to buy our products.
Fantastic. And can you give us a bit of an insight into what those what the products looked like, even with the early days, the ones obviously you can share with us, and how they helped your customers?
Yeah, so at the beginning was really an outgrowth of our research. So working with DARPA and NASA, we specialized on building artificial intelligence that emulates aspect of animal behavior, if you will, in a form factor that you can put it on a mobile robot, right? So imagine that you are a Mars rover robot and you need to explore an uncharted environment, and you don't want to connect to Earth for every single move. You need your intelligence and learning, perception and everything to be run directly on site on the robot. So we built that, which was very difficult from the technical perspective, but then we looked at how can we sell this to the market. And with our with our surprise, we realized that there are not that many robots out there to sell it to. Back then, we're talking 2012, 13, 14, the amount of robots deployed in the field was really scant, very few. And we couldn't create a market. The drone industry started to pick up initially with consumer, and then than enterprise drones later on. But we essentially found other sources of revenue, mostly with cameras, which, unlike robots, they were really, really common and inexpensive. And so we started to deploy our AI with real customers, in particular in the consumer electronic field, cell phone manufacturers that wanted to add AI, in particular at the beginning, to help with digital photography. So how can you create an expert photographer picture without knowing anything about photography? So AI was basically emulating this by giving intelligence to cameras. So we took a small subset of our robotic expertise, just about the perception side, and started to deploy that initially, and, you know, put our AI in about 56, 57 million devices up to date.
Wow, amazing. And just going up to, I mean, obviously that's one area there. Where have you seen the growth in perhaps particularly from the research that you've done? Where have you seen the growth coming from, and where do you see it coming from in the near future?
Yeah, so that's interesting because, you know, again, we were looking at ways in which we can deploy our unique AI, right? So not all AIs do the same thing. We don't do, for instance, speech processing or, you know, financial forecasting or you know, or the like with AI. So our AI was designed to basically service a use case where you need your AI to run very little compute hardware directly on the device, right? So you don't have a server and you want to instantaneously teach something. And so over the course of years, we have found our path. And we recently launched a product that is called Neurala VIA, which stands for Visual Inspection Automation, that is devoted for industrial inspections. And you might think, well, how is that related with, you know, Mars Rover? And it's actually very, very related, because you are essentially in a small compute factor inside a gigantic robot, which is an industrial machine that cannot rely on an internet connection to operate. You know, I'm talking here about machines that spit out product like the one you're wearing right now in your head. It's a headset. You know, those are designed by industrial machines and, you know, in complex, you know, manufacturing facilities where products come out very, very quickly from industrial machines and need additional pair of eyes to control the quality and make sure that the product complies, you know, with all the quality standards. And we figured out that our technology has a huge demand and impact in this sort of use cases where you need very quick, very fast to configure AI that can run directly in these industrial applications. So that's where we are focusing right now, which is, you know, kind of different than autonomous robots, but those robots are nowhere to be found at scale for us to, you know, become a wealthy company.
How was, you know, obviously you've got you're growing, you've got 40 people I know in the company, mostly US based. Tell us what a typical day in the business looks like for you, Max, at the moment.
Well, for me, you know, since the time I try to wake up early because I have four kids at home, and so it's usually me early, you know, 5:30-ish, having breakfast and checking emails with my dog, who is, you know, obviously with me all the time during my morning. And it basically starts like that, you know, checking emails. And then, you know, now the challenge, you know, newly introduced since March is we don't go to an office anymore. So you go to your home office, you go to, you know, some other temp space. We are actually about to rent a temporary space this week to start to resume pseudo-normal operation for the company. But, you know, as of today, we are all virtual. And so you start, you open up your calendar and check how many Zoom meeting or video conference meetings you have. And then you go through the motion of those meetings, trying to have them as many as possible, because the issue with these days is the lack of constant communication that a physical office actually allows you.
Well, it's interesting you talked about there about, you know, opening a temporary office or however you're bringing back. Some companies have chosen to say, hey, look, we're not going to do that anymore. Others can't wait to reconnect. What's been that decision making process for you, and why have you taken that approach now?
Well, I mean, artificial intelligence and neural network work from taking example from the past and trying to forecast the future, right? So that's how they work. If I do the same with you know, our office opening, Neurala would not have started, you know, as a company if we me, Anatoly, and Heather were not bumping into each other constantly every day and sitting together face to face in a coffee shop.
Yeah.
So, period. So, whoever says the opposite, I think, is misinformed. Or, you know, maybe they should try to start up a company through Zoom and then let me know how it goes. To me, it's extremely naive to think that, you know, you can just move to Zoom and then everything is fine. It's just not how it is, and it will never be.
What have you seen as the challenges of you know, since obviously COVID came in and the lockdown in the business? What's been the most challenges for you? But what do you see also as the opportunities, do you think, moving forward?
Well, I mean, the challenges is there is a whole set of things that happen in a face-to-face conversation which are not allowed by Zoom. So that the, you know, the non-verbal communication, the empathic part, just the vibe of meeting a person face-to-face, if you are either acquiring that as a customer or as an employee, they're not the same as Zoom. And I think there is an issue of trust. You know, you're just an image on the screen. Are you a real person? Is what you're telling me the truth? You know, those are real issues. I think there are opportunities as well. In our case, if you're thinking about the future where there would be a potential part of the company decentralized, then and also putting that together with the geopolitical situation and the geo health situation given to COVID, the idea of opening up a subsidiary, in, for instance, in Europe, has many appeal. Much appeal for us, reduced cost of labor, independence from transatlantic travel, and you know, if you are going to be remote, you might as well do it in a place where the cost of labor is low, companies have a higher, you know, ability to retain you and so forth. So that's an opportunity to me that COVID has opened and accelerated.
What do you see perhaps as the you know, people have obviously, I don't know how your team have been, but I know some people have been felt isolated at times. It's been difficult having that remote working, not for everyone. What have you done over the last 3 months really to keep your team engaged and motivated? You know, what are the things that you've been doing from the top?
Yeah, so first of all, we already had the habit of remote workers. So actually, you know, okay. I told you that all our workers are in US, but in reality, we have two offices. One is very small with a couple of people in, you know, west of Massachusetts, and the other one is in Boston. So it's far enough that it's 3 hours to enable us anyway to always have Zoom windows open, even when we are all in the office. And so we also had a policy that employees could work from home once per week. And so basically what happened during coronavirus is that everybody is now on Zoom versus we had 5, 6 people, 7 people on Zoom. So it was more of a quantitative change rather than qualitative. So that was good. And what we have done is we have increased the you know, company-wide meetings. We have started to do one-on-one session between, you know, the CEO, which is me, and all the employees to just chat about how they're holding up. We have scouted and are going to open a temporary office space, which will enable a fraction of the company to use it, but also enable team meetings to occur for brainstorming in person, which are difficult to substitute through Zoom. So it's a series of processes just to, you know, to mitigate the, you know, black or white situation that this affords.
Yeah. Now, I know we've got listeners from Italy to the podcast. What I was curious about your own journey. What took you to the US and perhaps what was the experience like for you? And what would you recommend to others who are contemplating, you know, perhaps either going to the US in the future or perhaps moving abroad? How's it impacted you?
Well, I mean, coming to the US from Italy is, you know, has a double-edged sword, right? So the one is the positive is working, right? Working in the US in my field was really impossible to do in Italy, right? So there is no NASA in Italy, there is no DARPA. You are really at the periphery of the AI revolution. At least you were back then, and so for me it was an obvious choice to come and work here. Obviously, US is not Italy in terms of everything else. You know, Italy is Italy. You eat well, you live well. The landscape is phenomenal, and it's your home. So you obviously lose a lot. And so nowadays, working remotely is a little bit better. And companies like main companies of the U.S. open up office internationally. So you have a choice of working for those company even remotely or in your own country. So that's a little easier to do. So
that's right. And Max, what's the you've obviously been through tremendous change, certainly through this period, I'm sure one of the biggest, but I'm sure there's been during your journey of the company, what's the best piece of advice you would give to anyone going through tremendous business change?
Well, first of all, go through the changes with your good friends, right? So don't try to be alone in this. And for us, it has been very important to have co-founders like Heather and Anatoly around, and importantly, also very importantly, investors that are not new to the job and have a humane approach to this. And mm-hmm. I have to thank my main investor, the people on my board to basically be a companion in this journey rather than just critics of do more or try to evict coronavirus by yourself. And so that's really important, surrounding yourself by strong partners in this.
Mm-hmm. What do you think the next 12 to 18 months and maybe even further out looks like, particularly for your industry? Exciting times. And how might that impact your business model as well, do you think?
So first of all, I think we are in front of more of a, if I have to put a sport metaphor here, is more of a marathon rather than a sprint. The next few months will be long and jittery. And I think the best approach is to think of this as as a long marathon where there are going to be setbacks, and you have to be sure that you have enough stamina to survive it. And so that's the first thing. The second thing is actually a surprising positive. I am in the artificial intelligence business, and until February of 2019, the typical dialogue around AI was robots are going to take over the world and kill us all. Then in March, when we needed robots to, take temperature, disinfect hospital, work in factories that were deserted by employees, people were asking, where are the robots that we have been talking about? And so there has been a 180 shift in the, in the dialogue around AI, where people were, mostly the uninformed and, the one looking for advertisement and, easy pickup from CNN. They were saying, we are doomed, the AI is going to kill us all. But mm-hmm. then when we needed the robots, those guys disappeared, thankfully. And, Elon Musk and company, for instance, they went under a stone. And people started to ask for those robots because we need them very quickly and very efficiently to, disinfect hospital, run warehouse fulfillment center, and help with manufacturing with a dissipating workforce. Even before COVID, they were dissipating. Even now even faster.
Mm. Yeah, interesting times. And what are the kind of people, Max, who are now the people you're keen to connect with, reach out to? Who are those people you're interested in building relationships with?
Well, today we are building very quickly relationship with industrial manufacturers, system integrators, everybody in the in the industry 4.0 movement that are mm-hmm. looking to create these factories that are more and more autonomous, or injected with autonomous technology and automation to help function even in times where things might be destroyed or disrupted by external events.
Who are you seeing doing that really exceptionally well, and who are perhaps at the needing to catch up a little bit?
Neuralink is doing it well, right? Obviously, but I think that I would say, without naming names, I think that there are several startups that are attacking these very quickly and in an agile way, by saying the right things and providing the right products. I think larger companies are a little bit catching up into the AI wave, and AI is actually a very elite you know, discipline, if you're thinking about the you know, the real number of experts that understand it, it's very, very small. And despite people can today download a software package and run a neural network, that's not really understanding it. And so whenever you have to do something that goes a little bit outside of, you know, the bread and butter of AI, then, you know, the real expert come out. And those are not easy to find. And so large companies that have avoided AI until now, they're kind of rushing and, you know, getting into this field. But the talent available is not always, you know, the quality of needed and in the numbers that they need.
What if you were giving your 20-year-old self one piece of advice, Max? Lastly, what would you say to yourself now, looking back?
To myself, you know, I think one thing that I'm happy that I did and I kept doing is working in a field where I have a passion for it, right? And so that was actually my dad teaching to me. You know, he's been working as a lawyer until the last day, and he never, you know, looked back and or you know, say, I wish I had another job. And so he did what he had a passion for, and I want to do the same. I want to work where I have a passion for. The thing that I would have done better maybe is, you know, don't pick up only projects that are technically fun, but also pick up projects that are, you know, create a deployment for the technology. And sometimes, you know, the scientist in me wants to pick up the most difficult or intriguing project, but there are some projects that are dumber, if you will, or easier to do, that can lead to a real deployment, that sometimes we say, let's not do those.
Yeah, understood. Yeah. Well, Max, look, thanks for joining me. I really appreciate jumping on the line today. If people want to connect with you, find out more about the company, which is really interesting, and thanks for sharing so many insights, how can they do that?
Yeah, absolutely. So they can either reach us at Neurala, which is www.neurala.com, or they can look for Max Versace, which is my personal website, and just shoot me you know, an email from the form.
Hey, Max, thanks for joining us. And yeah, good luck for the rest of the year.
Absolutely. Likewise. Good luck to you guys.
We really hope you enjoyed the podcast today. If you want to listen to more exclusive tips and life lessons from our guest, go to the resources page at vineresources.com.